pleasure to have you here, and we will try to bring you an interesting full day, a packed day of content. And we prepared Alex and me slides today, and we'll quickly run through that first part and set a little bit of stage what will happen today. It is not only about the program, but also very quickly putting things into perspective. And the purpose of networking is information dissemination of picking port numbers. Alex asked, where do you think you have that quote from? Well, if you don't have something to quote, you have to create it first. So it's perhaps the first time we've seen that, and now we can quote it. It points out...
Whose quote is it? Whose quote is it? Yours?
Well, in this case, it's mine, yes.
So I can quote you now?
Yes, please. What I wanted to point out is, if you take what we had in the past and sometimes still use that today, well, you write down that nice URL or you click and then it expanded by that click. What you would like to move to is something like that, instead of telling that there is a repo 13 at port 8444 with that server, you just name the content and the privilege looks different. It's not like you get from some source. It's really, you get your packet data. It looks like a minor thing, but I will quickly come back to that. It's not that minor. There are some advantages and advances here, what we get out of such a shift from the different class. Of course, the host names are not there anymore. You rename the data, not where it is, and the authenticity is linked to the data, not the web server. Think about repo 13 content.cold. And you have here.pdf. Is it the same data? You don't know. Maybe it's the same, maybe not. With the same name, what content here, you know, it's that content that I want. It's a unique name for the content, and this is one of the properties we wish to have. Because it's not humans looking at these references to names, to this data. It is in the future, it's machine to machine, it's programs fetching part of their data structures from the vast network of content. And here we need assurance that we really get the data that we need. Otherwise, we cannot scale that thing. We cannot have the humans in the loop of fetching content to verify the origin or the accuracy of the content. So, you know most of the thing. I go really quickly through that for people coming from outside. I want to very kind of brief primer on what ICN is. It started with the concept that you ask the network for some piece of data, and that will typically be the case when we have projects like NDN or CCNX. There have been those starting with that concept. It was later generalized by also having results, not only data. You use multiple names and you say, I have this function, please apply to this data. Also here you would like to have authenticity. You really invoke the maximum or the average function that applies to that authentic data that you name. And then we have name function networking. It's roughly the same. You ask the network to do something for you, and in both cases, you get back a reply. And the reply, that is the important part here. It has the name or the expression in it, it has the data and result, and it has a cryptographic binding. So you know if you get that piece of data with that name, you really get back what you really wanted, nothing else. It doesn't depend on the host or whatever, it is really a piece of data. You can get it from your neighbor, the Europe page. Front page can be delivered from Fargo to me, and I can look at the authenticity without having to contact the server. So no ports, no host names, everything is embedded in that name, complex name or simple name, it's more or less the same request reply. Applied to IoT setting, in a home setting, if you connect to an IoT solution, you would have to somehow know where things are when you talk to a specific IP address or a broadcast domain and you request things to happen. It is visible at the programming interface. With ICN, we hope that we can come up with a solution where the network is in charge of sorting out these details for you. You really operate at the level of high-level data names and operations on these names. Three principles have been proposed from the very early beginning on how that should be. The first is kind of protocol. If you're sitting on one node machine, how do you talk to the next one? It is the flow balance thing. You ask for one item, you get back one item. You can, of course, ask for 10 items in one row, and then you will get think about the difference of this so-called receiver-driven mode to what we have today. If you contact a web server, send the first TCP sync packet, you might get half a megabyte, 10 megabytes just from at you, and you have no control really, except we can play with some buffer, tuning how much you will receive. Here you completely control how much data you get back by pensing the so-called requests and the slow balance. One request, one reply, and you paste the number of requests you put into the network. This creates a closed feedback loop. You know what is happening in the network. You can also measure, understand better what is happening. And it's also possible that you not only ask one potential source, you can ask in many directions for the same content, and you just pick the first content coming back. So there's a deduplication built into the system. If you get back the same content multiple times, the network will only deliver it once per year. The naming is very important, the so-called namespace design. There are different components. Some work with hierarchical names. We are mostly working with that today. With name function, you have name composition coming with that also. You can also use hash values to identify content. There are different flavors of naming, but the naming is definitely an important part. And then I mentioned that the securing of the packet, linking the name with the content that you have found, that is really a core property of our setup. If you want to not have more catch names here, immutable name data would be something to keep in mind. Because once it has been named and cryptographically bound, you cannot undo it. You can rely on that, but you must be able to rely on that. That's really the core of our beliefs here. It has also a nice side benefit. You can do universal caching. It's the same content. It cannot change its content if you have a given name. Anybody can do caching for you, and especially, of course, network names. You will hear from time to time some of the technical terms we use in our field. The fifth, the pit, yes, let's quickly go through that. That is the canonical picture of forwarding node. Let me see if I can have some So the whole picture starts at the bottom. The forwarding information base is like routing. You say for this kind of content, for example, the prefix, so it's the Florida International University, everything should go to some specific direction if you have questions or want content from there. The name face is used instead of interface to have a more general view of how you can talk to the network. You see here to the right the different faces to mobile internet, to fixed internet, directed to the applications that could be sitting on your node. You can also ask your applications, can you deliver that data to me? It's really a protocol about fetching data from someone. So that the forwarding information base helps you to know where to ask. Now, if you have a question and you want to have a specific piece of data, you will send an interest and it will end up in the pending interest table. The node takes over for you to fetch that content and it keeps track of that. This is a stateful protocol, so that is the table where we keep track of pending interest. If someone else asks for the same request, the request is still pending, it will be just appended. It will not issue a second triggering of asking. It will wait for that single answer and then fan it out. We see in the middle where this middle line has two faces, one and the two. That is where the interest came in. When the content comes back, it will be delivered to these two faces that both are happy with a single request that we got back from the network. We can serve two clients. That's the PIT. And the content store is just another word for the cache. That's where we can link these names with their content, and that is where we can speed up things. If a few minutes later the same content is asked, we can serve it from here instead of having to ask the So, what is in the package today? That is just 1 mile away from here, Hackerstraße. Here we have Hacker Place. It's a place where you can really get your hands dirty. And what we suggest is that you use it from different angle of your interest. We didn't know from the beginning how the audience would be composed, so we tried to have a very but also the more interested, if you want to get involved, or even if you want to have a project and hack on it, please come. The second way to sell it is, well, there are three cool things around here, ICN, IoT, and Riot. Why not put them all in one day and here you have that day? This is the plan for exactly that. What we have is a first part where we will bring you the fundamentals, what you should know, what you should be able then to understand in order to then go to the second part. We will have hands-on tracks and one consume only track and here. Depending on your interest, you go in one of these tracks. I will show you the timetable in a minute or a few seconds. At the end, we bring everybody back together. We would be interested on your experience. What did you learn? What did you find puzzling? It's always good to see how people not so in the core group, having, for example, now set up that tutorial, see the world and what they missed and what they liked. So that is bring together everybody. I mentioned the PIT, the FIP, the content store. Let's quickly go through a few names that you also will see. It's easy to log and lose yourself in this acronym. CCNX is really the start of the, many of the things we are doing today. And Xerox Park around 2008. It has now SQL. It is now the whole software package and has been bought by Cisco and is developed there. It is now CICN, and there is a half-day tutorial on that at this place here. There is the NDN testbed, that is independent, wide format, incompatible to some extent, the form, if you want. But most of the concepts have remained the same. It is a different set of people driving that. UCLA was very prominent and still is, but a lot of other universities in the US and worldwide, there is a global testbed where you can really run that today. CCN Lite is a side activity. It is not really a fork. It tries to be compatible with the packet format. And when the NDN fork happened, it also wanted to be compatible with that packet format. And it has the philosophy of being lean, a very easy way to experiment, to change things. The old CCNX software was really a monster in size. And also NDN is quite impressive. How much data source code you have. CCN Lite was a kind of a counter reaction to that. And we have NFN named function networking, I mentioned that, where it's not only the network and memory, we have now network, memory, and computation bringing to So these are the players, if you wish. Now the presenters, it's, oh, I forgot why, sorry about that. We have that important part yesterday, the Riot Summit, and the now the Riot is the operating system for the Internet of Things. Now it's the information-centric network of things that's arrived. A few logos and these three backgrounds. These teams have come together to create a tutorial day. You see all the names. You will see the presenters in the different tracks and presentation slots. So let's move to the program, and the first part until lunch is after this initial few words, just a few minutes late. We will have Oleg making that link about IoT and ICN. We will give you a quick demo of what can be achieved today with the stitching things today that we have, and there will be then after that people in. Everybody will be involved. We have chosen to have a setup where you don't have to create an environment in your laptop. We will hand out devices pre-configured, so it's very easy for onboarding and you can try out stuff. So you will get Raspberry Pis and really hello world experience. I'm really curious to see how that works. The break, then Alex will talk about the security concepts in more details, what you have to know about signing, trust, how that is established in that environment. The NDN Riot project, we will also present CCN Lite, and the IoT lab for testing. These are four additional slots after the break. After lunch, there are two more preparation slots for just telling you what you can do on Android on NDN and what NFN is about. And then we split up in three different tracks depending on your interest. there is track one, showing mini NDA, it's really kind of the demo style, consume only. And the track two and three are the more hackerish style, where we try to let you try out new stuff, modify things you have prepared for you. If you're interested more on the Riot side, it's track two on in room 46, and the more NFN side, CC and Light, is in room 51. In the other room, you see it's a break in between, but then they convince it's 2 times 1 hour for each of the track. At the end, we reconvene at 5:10 for another 45 minutes of reflecting on what we have learned.